I'll read out to you the summary of what he said in the previous one so that we get the continuity. In the previous para, he has said, but most importantly, these three characteristics of matter, ignorance, inertia, and division, impose on life and mind the law of pain and suffering, dissatisfaction, and consequent unrest. But ignorance would not bring pain and suffering if mental consciousness were totally ignorant. The very unawareness of its own ignorance would not impose pain. But precisely because the emerging consciousness becomes aware of its limitation, ignorance and weakness, which render the being incapable of dealing effectively with the impacts of the external world, there is dissatisfaction and unrest resulting in pain and suffering. To be happy, there has to be satisfaction. Satisfaction comes by conquest and overcoming of obstacles and problems. But limitation of knowledge and power ends in failure, incapacity, which bring dissatisfaction and therefore pain and suffering. All limitation gives dissatisfaction. The infinite alone can give total ananda. And hence the Vedantic dictum, anantam anandam. Anantam is equal to anandam. Similarly, what is true of ignorance and pain is also true of inertia and vital sentience. Paradoxically, it is the growth and emergence of life and mind from matter that give rise to pain and suffering. If consciousness is not there, there won't be any pain. You're not aware of your anything. So if consciousness, strangely enough, consciousness grows, pain comes. Then when you lose your identification with body, mind, life, again pain disappears. So we go to the next para. And when in man, life becomes wholly self-conscious, this unavoidable struggle and effort and aspiration reach their acme, and the pain and discord of the world becomes finally too keenly sensible to be borne with contentment. Man may, for a long time, quiet himself by seeking to be satisfied with his limitations or by confining his struggle to such mastery as he can gain over his material world, over this material world he inhabits. Some mental and physical triumph of his progressive knowledge over its inconscient fixities, of his small, concentrated, conscious will and power over its inertly driven, monstrous forces. But here too, he finds the limitation, the poor inconclusiveness of the greatest results he can achieve, and is obliged to look beyond. The finite cannot remain permanently satisfied so long as it is conscious either of a finite greater than itself or of an infinite beyond itself to which it can yet aspire. And if the finite could be so satisfied, yet the apparently finite being who feels himself to be really an infinite or feels merely the presence or the impulse and stirring of an infinite within can never be satisfied till these two are reconciled, till that is possessed by him and he is possessed by it in whatever degree or manner. Man is such a finite seeming infinity and cannot fail to arrive at a seeking after the infinite. He is the first son of earth to become vaguely aware of God within him, of his immortality or of his need for immortality. And the knowledge is a whip that drives and a cross of crucifixion until he is able to turn it into a source of infinite light and joy and power. So we must remember the context, and then we'll have to say this. He is explaining in this chapter why the ascetic rejects body, mind, life and matter and goes above matter and into the higher levels of consciousness. Swami is saying, no, we will not do that. We will transform the body, mind, life. So Swami is now, in a sense, justifying temporarily the ascetic's tendency to get rid of matter and its problems. And matter is imposing severely its limitations on the aspirant in three ways: ignorance, law of fixity, the laws, okay, and finally the division. It gets divided. These are the three things that he is talking about, okay. So this is ignorance, inertia and division of matter. So ignorance is total, there is no knowledge in matter at all. Inertia is a very big element in matter. Inertia, and also he also talks of the laws, the fixity of laws, okay. Mechanical energy, fixity of laws, and division of matter. These are the three things that are creating the problems for the aspirant. Okay? I'll read each sentence. And when in man life becomes wholly self-conscious, this unavoidable struggle and effort and aspiration reach their acme, and the pain and discord of the world become finally too keenly sensible to be borne with contentment. So, he has already told us earlier that if consciousness is not there, there is no pain. But the moment consciousness comes in, you start becoming aware of your own limitations, and limitations give you dissatisfaction, and dissatisfaction will give pain. Okay, so strangely enough, it's contradictory. The more the consciousness grows, the more the pain can come, okay, up to a certain level. So this is what he's saying. So man in life becomes wholly self-conscious. Okay, this unavoidable struggle and effort and aspiration reach their acme. He's telling three things: struggle, effort and aspiration. Why does aspiration come? Because the animal is not aware of its limitations. Man is aware of his limitations. He wants to do something, he can't. So he can conceive of a thing which is the opposite of his own. If he sees death anywhere, he can think of immortality. If he sees limitation, he can think of omnipotence. If he sees ignorance, he can think of utter omniscience. So that is why the problem comes. At the animal level, this is not there. They'll bear the pain mechanically without self-suffering. But in man, there is self-suffering because he is conscious of his own limitations. But now Swami is saying, man may for a long time quiet himself by seeking to be satisfied with his limitations, or by confining his struggle to such mastery as he can gain over the material world he inhabits. Some mental and physical triumph of his progressive knowledge over its inconscient fixities, of his small, concentrated conscious will and power over its inertly driven monstrous forces. This can apply very well to science, okay? But man may for a long time quiet himself by seeking to be satisfied with his limitations. Most human beings do that, no? They are not thinking of yoga or anything. There are limitations, you say, what can we do about it? You have to adjust yourself to it. They are quite satisfied with it, okay? Up to a certain point. But a time comes when you can't be satisfied with that. You have feel the need. That's why he's using the word aspiration. The moment the word aspiration comes, then this sentence, what Swami is saying here, quiet himself by seeking to be satisfied with limitations, the aspiration probably not there yet. But the moment the aspiration comes, he can't be satisfied because he knows that there is something else. By long time quiet himself by seeking to be satisfied with limitations, or by confining his struggle to such mastery as he can gain over this material worldly inhabits. So he is talking of psychological difficult limitations as well as the physical limitations, because he is talking of material worldly inhabits. So this applies to science also. Science has to be satisfied with whatever knowledge it has got and how much power it has got over nature. But science also is not satisfied. It is constantly trying to go beyond what it knows. Okay. Some mental and physical triumph over his progressive knowledge over its inconscient fixities. Which are the inconscient fixities? The laws of nature. You can't do anything about a storm. You have to adjust it. The tsunami that comes, they are inconscient and they are fixities of nature. You can't do anything about it. But now man is trying to do even that to a certain extent. Of his small, concentrated conscious will and power over its inertly driven monstrous forces. Again, inertly driven monstrous forces, very similar to inconscient fixities. Inertly driven monstrous forces, storms, earthquakes, okay, tsunamis, not man-made, nature. Okay, that's why he's talking of inertly driven monstrous forces. But here too he finds a limitation, the poor inconclusiveness of the greatest results he can achieve, and is obliged to look beyond. This sentence fits science perfectly. Okay, so here too in the physical world he finds a limitation, the poor inconclusiveness of the greatest results he can achieve, and is obliged to look beyond. One good example of this is, earlier when the storms used to come, we never knew that the storm is going to come. When it comes, you undergo all the pain and suffering and the destruction. Now, we are going out, science has managed to go into space, and we have satellites, and we can see the storm developing even 3 days, 4 days earlier. So now you can have a little bit of control over it. So now when you know the storm is coming, you can evacuate the people, and to a certain extent you can control it. That's what he's mentioning. Okay, so he's saying, here too he finds a limitation, the poor inconclusiveness of the greatest results he can achieve, and is obliged to look beyond. The finite cannot remain permanently satisfied so long as it is conscious either of a finite greater than itself or of an infinite beyond itself, to which it can aspire. If he is not conscious that there is a solution to the problem, then he will be satisfied, or rather he will try to satisfy himself and remain quiet. I remember, I always give this example, okay? So there was someone who knew that he is arrogant, but he used to say, I can do nothing about it. The idea that he can do something about it has not yet come. So then you quiet yourself when you satisfy yourself and saying there is nothing I can do about it. Okay. So same thing even science also, if you say the storm came, that's the nature of the universe. But now we know that there is some you can control to a certain extent. But the moment you know that you can control your arrogance, your anger and all that, then you cannot remain satisfied. You have to go beyond. That's what he's saying. So, here too he finds a limitation, the poor inconclusiveness of greatest results he can achieve, and is obliged to look beyond. The finite cannot remain permanently satisfied so long as it is conscious either of a finite greater than itself or of an infinite beyond itself to which it can aspire, to which it can yet aspire. And if the finite could be so satisfied, yet the apparently finite being who feels himself to be really an infinite, or feels merely the presence or the impulse and stirring of an infinite within, can never be satisfied till these two are reconciled. Till that is possessed by him and he is possessed by it in whatever degree or manner. Sri Ramda is very fond of saying that you must possess the divine and the divine must possess you. So he goes on saying that. It's not enough to be possessed. You must also possess him. Suppose you are possessed by the divine, then it's a passive state, huh? But if you possess the divine, you have the power of the divine also, and it's not a passive state anymore. It's an active state. So he says that all the time. Okay, so now it's very clear what he's saying, and that when you are conscious that there is a solution to the problem, that there is something, not solution even, but there is something that is greater than this, an infinite or a finite greater than the self, then he cannot remain satisfied. Otherwise, he has to adjust himself and quiet himself and console himself. Then there is nothing I can do about it. That's what he is saying. In fact, that is the, as far as I understand, the existentialist theory. Okay, that this is the nature of the world. There is suffering, there is limitation. But what can you do about it? You have to accept it quietly. Okay. So, this is the, but if they know that, no, there is a solution to it and there is something that you can do something about it, then you start your yogic practices and you have a different view of things. Okay? So, what is this reconciling he's talking about? Reconciling of your limitations and the possibility of going beyond. No? Till that is possessed by him and he is possessed by it in whatever degree or manner. And Sri Ramda is purposely saying that because your idea of what may be different, it may be in, he is applying the word that in a sense, very general sense, it could be material forces, it could be psychological forces, it could be anything. He is not specifying. It could be in knowledge, it could be in force, it could be in ananda, everywhere. Man is such a finite seeming infinity, okay, and cannot fail to arrive at a seeking after the infinite. So this he says very clearly, that the animal is limited in consciousness and cannot do this because it can't conceive of immortality. It sees death, but he can't do anything about it. But man, when he sees death, he can think of immortality. When he sees limitation, he can think of going beyond the limitation. When he sees suffering, he can think of ananda. So that's why the moment he is aware of his limitations, he wants to go beyond. And man is like that. That's the, he says that in many places, that man is a, the advent of man in the evolution is a very important step, and it reverses the whole process. That evolution which was mechanical and inconscient now starts becoming conscient and willed. It can become. Okay? So,
saying that not only he can seek the infinite, he's saying he will inevitably.
Yes, that's right.
No two ways about it.
That's right. He is the first son of earth who becomes vaguely aware of God within him, of his immortality or of his need for immortality. And the knowledge is a whip that drives at a cross of crucifixion until he is able to turn it into a source of infinite light and joy and power. So, knowledge is double. It's a whip. Knowledge says there is something that you can do about it. But it's also, it makes you aware of your own cross of crucifixion, your limitations, until he is able to turn it into a source of infinite light and joy and power. He can turn his suffering into ananda. He can turn his limitations into power. He can turn his weakness into power. And he can turn his ignorance into knowledge. Man has the capacity. Man is such a finite seeming infinity. He seems to be finite, but he is actually, his consciousness can go to the infinite. Okay?
Nangata, just as the cross of crucifixion is the image associated with Christ, Is this phrase also whip that drives also referring to some personality? Just a thought.
Oh, the knowledge is a whip that drives. And a cross of crucifixion until he is able to turn it into a source of infinite light. Okay, it's interesting what you're saying. Knowledge is like a whip that drives the bullock or the horse. Yeah. It makes it go faster. So knowledge is like a whip. It's an interesting image he's using. Yeah. So, in fact, Sri Aurobindo always uses images, and we have to see the relevance of the image to what he's saying. So, when you have a whip in your hand and you want your horse or your bullock or whatever animal you are driving to go faster, you whip it. So, knowledge is a whip that makes you go faster and to seek faster. Fantastic. And a cross of crucifixion until he is able to turn it into a source of infinite light and joy and power. Crucifixion is your limitation, a symbol of your limitation and suffering. Okay. We go to the next para. This progressive development, this growing manifestation of the divine consciousness and force, knowledge and will that had lost itself in the ignorance and inertia of matter might well be a happy efflorescence proceeding from joy to greater and at last to infinite joy, if it were not for the principle of rigid division from which matter has started. The shutting up of the individual in his own personal consciousness of separate and limited mind, life and body prevents what would otherwise be the natural law of our development. It brings into the body the law of attraction and repulsion, of defense and attack, of discord and pain. For each body, being a limited conscious force, feels itself exposed to the attack, impact, forceful contact of other such limited conscious forces or of universal forces, and where it feels itself broken in upon or unable to harmonize the contacting and recipient consciousness, it suffers discomfort and pain, is attracted or repelled, has to defend itself or to assail. It is constantly called upon to undergo what it is unwilling or unable to suffer. Into the emotional and the sense mind, the law of division brings the same reactions with the higher values of grief and joy, love and hatred, oppression and depression, all cast into terms of desire, and by desire into straining and effort, and by straining into excess and defect of force, incapacity, the rhythm of attainment and disappointment, possession and recoil, a constant strife and trouble and unease. Into the mind as a whole, instead of a divine law of narrower truth flowing into greater truth, lesser light taken up into wider light, lower will surrendered to higher transforming will, pettier satisfaction progressing towards nobler and more complete satisfaction, it brings similar dualities of truth pursued by error, light by darkness, power by incapacity, pleasure of pursuit and attainment by pain of repulse and of dissatisfaction with what is attained. Mind takes up its own affliction along with the affliction of life and body and becomes aware of the triple defect and insufficiency of our natural being. All this means the denial of Ananda, the negation of the Trinity of Satchidananda, and therefore, if the negation is insuperable, the futility of existence. For existence, in throwing itself out in the play of consciousness and force, must seek that movement, not merely for itself, but for satisfaction in the play. And if in the play no real satisfaction can be found, it must obviously be abandoned in the end as a vain attempt, a colossal mistake, a delirium of the self-embodying spirit. This is the justification for the ascetic to give up the physical world. He has been dealing earlier with ignorance, then he has dealt with the fixity of laws, inertia. Now in this paragraph he is discussing division. How division affects physical, vital, mental. You can see the gradation. So we'll have a look at that a little carefully. Okay, so before that, just 1 second. We'll do one thing. We'll quickly go through the summary of what he's saying. Then we'll look at his sentence. Okay, so in the spiritual evolution from the inconscient to the superconscient, the involved divine consciousness, force, ananda, might have flowered into a wonderful culmination of overt Satchidananda. But the resistance of matter with its density and darkness does not allow this happy ending. The individual, having undergone the principle of division, lives in a narrow, self-enclosed, egoistic shell. He feels the attack of others on himself and has constantly to defend himself and also to counter-attack. He cannot harmonize his own being with the invasion of the external world impacts on his being. Thus, there is a constant acute struggle caused by desire between attainment and failure, attraction and repulsion. This struggle results in dissatisfaction and disappointment, ending in a desire to escape permanently from this world of strife and suffering. The ascetic seems justified in his escape from this madhouse or lunatic asylum. That's what Srimadhi is saying. He's saying delirium, colossal mistake. And this lunatic asylum he has used other places. That's why I'm using the word. Okay? There are philosophies which say that this world is a lunatic asylum. There is no order, no total chaos and all. They see the physical world as, you know, that some see it as illusion, some see it as absolutely a chaos. So, this is what he's saying. So now, we can look at each sentence. Okay, so first what he's saying is very clear. If division were not there, man would not be limited to himself. The division starts from the atom. But it also affects everything above it also, up to the mind level. Above the mind, division stops. You start seeing the oneness of things. But matter, life and mind, division operates. It operates even from the higher levels, but less. Okay, so, because when you go to the higher mind level, you start seeing the oneness. The oneness starts, you start seeing. So, this progressive development, this growing manifestation of the divine consciousness and force, knowledge and will. So, consciousness and force, chit and shakti. Knowledge and will is the same thing as a result. Consciousness results in knowledge, okay? And force results in will. Will is force directed to a specific purpose. That is will. So, that's why he's using both the words.
Subjective and objective.
Yes. You can say that, yeah.
He says, Satchidananda is Satyam Jnanam Ananta.
Yes.
Chit is Jnanam.
Yes. So, consciousness and force, knowledge and will, that had lost itself in the ignorance and inertia of matter. So, inertia and ignorance are the first two problems of to the ascetic. Now, in this para, he is going to discuss the division, okay? So, might well be a happy efflorescence proceeding from joy to greater and at last to infinite joy, if it were not for the principle of rigid division from which matter has started. He has finished discussing ignorance and inertia, now he is discussing division from which matter has started. The shutting up of the individual in his own personal consciousness of separate and limited mind, life and body prevents what would otherwise be the natural law of our development. If he were not limited to his body, mind, life, he would be aware of his oneness with others. There would be a natural development which happens after the yogi goes to the higher level. It becomes a natural development. So it brings into the body law of attraction and repulsion. Now he is talking of the body, then he will apply the same laws of attraction and repulsion in the vital, then he will apply the same law of attraction and repulsion in the mind. Okay, he is going step by step. First he is speaking of the mind. It brings into the body the law of attraction and repulsion, of defense and attack, of discord and pain. Okay, so why? There are certain things you are attracted to. Okay, it can be food, it can be pleasantnesses, okay, and repulsion. Just actually in matter, attraction and repulsion is a very fundamental law, that of magnets, okay. So attraction and repulsion starts from the lowest level and goes right up to the highest level. It's very interesting to discuss this, okay. So at the lowest level, in matter, you have attraction and repulsion. Magnets. Now when you come to the body also is attracted to certain things, pleasant things and unpleasant things it doesn't want. So this is the in the body. And so when there is attraction and repulsion, defense and attack naturally. Okay? If repulsion is there, it has to defend and attack of discord and pain. Therefore, discord and pain. Okay? For each body being a limited conscious force, feels itself exposed to the attack, impact, forceful contact of other such limited conscious forces or of universal forces, and where it feels itself broken in upon or unable to harmonize the contacting and the recipient consciousness, it suffers discomfort and pain, is attracted or repelled, has to defend itself or to assail. This is at the body level. We can give ourselves examples. In food also we have attraction and repulsion. Okay, in the physical world also you have storms. If you have a very cold wind, you will be repelled. If you have a very pleasant wind, you will be attracted. Okay, so this happens everywhere. In winter, if there is a sun, you will enjoy it. But in summer, that same sun, you will not enjoy. Attraction and repulsion of defense and attacks. For each body being a limited conscious force, feels itself exposed to the attack, impact, forceful contact of other such limited, now very interesting, conscious forces or of universal forces. Universal forces, mechanical. Storms, okay, sunlight, all these things. But conscious forces also are there. There can be other beings who are going to attack you. Sometimes there are conscious forces are there at the vital level, na? So that also is there. So he is making a distinction very clearly between conscious force and also what's the word he is using? Conscious force and universal force. Universal force, unconscious. Wind, sun, storms, and conscious forces also can be there. Okay, conscious force also can even include someone who comes and gives you a blow. It's a bodily thing, so that also can be there. Or someone comes and caresses you, that's a bodily thing, so that is a conscious force. Okay, so this is there. Then he's saying, where it feels itself broken in upon and unable to harmonize the contacting and recipient consciousness, it suffers discomfort and pain, is attracted or repelled, has to defend itself or to assail. It is constantly called upon to undergo what it is unwilling or unable to suffer. Note, interestingly, how he is putting, it is unwilling or unable. Even if he is trying and willing, but he is unable to, that is there, and sometimes he may be unwilling also. Now, from the body, he is coming to the emotional aspect. The same laws he will apply. Into the emotional and the sense mind, the law of division brings the same reactions with the higher values of grief and joy. Now, that which was attraction and repulsion in the body level, now is becoming grief and joy. Okay? The same thing is changing. Love and hatred, oppression and depression, all cast into forms of desire. Naturally, because when you have grief and joy, you want more joy, so desire comes in. Okay, so love and hatred, oppression and depression, all cast into terms of desire, and by desire into straining and effort. Okay, and by the straining into excess and defect of force, incapacity, the rhythm of attainment and disappointment, possession and recoil, a constant strife and trouble and unease. So, the same division is giving this problem in the body, it is giving also problem in the vital, the emotional part. Now, he will come to the mind also. That also, he will say that the same thing is there also at the mind level. Law of division is imposing all this. We don't think of it that way, but that is what is happening. Into the mind. Now he comes to the mind, okay? Into the mind as a whole, instead of a divine law of narrower truth flowing into greater truth, lesser light taken up into wider light, lower will surrendered to a higher transforming will, pettier satisfaction progressing towards nobler and more complete satisfaction, it brings similar dualities of truth pursued by error, light by darkness, power by incapacity, pleasure of pursuit and attainment by pain of repulse and of dissatisfaction with what is attained. Mind takes up its own affliction along with the affliction of life and body and becomes aware of the triple defect and insufficiency of our natural being. So, what is the triple defect? Physical pain, emotional pain, intellectual pain. That's a triple defect. Okay, so, an insufficiency of our natural being. All this means the denial of ananda. So, in other words, he is coming to the conclusion, division in matter, the one becoming the many, infinitely many, is imposing restriction of ananda. Therefore, it becomes the denial of ananda, the negation of the trinity of Satchidananda. And therefore, if the negation is be insuperable, the futility of existence. This is the justification for the ascetic to reject the body, mind, life. For existence in throwing itself out into the play of consciousness and force must seek that movement not merely for itself, but for satisfaction in the play. And if in the play no real satisfaction can be found, it must obviously be abandoned in the end as a vain attempt, a colossal mistake, a delirium of the self-embodying spirit. A delirium of the self-embodying spirit. Spirit has come down into matter, and that was a mistake, he's saying. He is not saying the one who sees limitations and sees it in this way, he wants to escape from it. So, earlier, we have not discussed it today, but earlier he has told you, first problem of matter is ignorance. No knowledge at all. Total darkness. Second, fixity and mechanical laws. No freedom at all. He has used the word inertia, but it is no freedom at all. Total fixity of laws. That's why physics is possible. Physics is possible because it's total fixity of laws. I can forecast a tomorrow sunrise very accurately because there is a fixity. I can also tell a solar eclipse or lunar eclipse, partial or full, everything I can say because there is fixity of law. Fixity of law means no freedom at all. So that's the second problem. Third problem is the division of matter. And division of matter goes into life, division of life and division of mind also, individual also. So that is what is creating the problem. So once you go above the mind, when you make your mind silent and go above the mind, you have entered into the second level of the spiritual planes of consciousness. And the spiritual planes of consciousness, you start seeing the oneness. That's the self, the Atman, if you want, or the self, the witness self. So we stop here today and I'm telling you that this is, if you want to see the physical world in that way, that is why you end up with the pessimistic theory of the world. Yeah, the pessimistic theory of the world, there is existentialism, there is Mayavada. Shankara also in a certain sense, not fully, because Shankara admits the divine in the universe. He admits, but it is hidden. Okay, he admits tattvamasi, okay, soham asmi, and sarvam khalu idam brahman, he admits, Shankara. But still he says, if you want the divine, you have to go up. The divine in his fullness, you have to go up. You can't do it here.